Well, good morning, Spring Creek family. Hey, listen, happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there in the world. Dale, happy Father's Day to you.
Thank you very much.
You know, I'm not a father, well.
I know.
I'm a dog dad. Does that count?
There you go.
Okay,
yeah,
cool.
That should count for something.
I don't think my dog got me a gift, though.
We'll have to talk to him about that.
Yeah, we is.
Come on.
He wants his Scooby snacks, so I want a gift. No, I'll play it. Listen, it's such a good day. It's such a great day. And happy Juneteenth as well. Listen, let's sing about the goodness of our Father. Come on, Billy.
Thank you. Today I have a special message planned for you. It's called A Pilgrimage of Pain and Hope. As we get started, please bow your heads for a moment of prayer. Father, we are so grateful for this time we've had to worship you, to lift up your name, to thank you, God, for your presence in our life. And right now, I just pray that as we enter this time of worship around your word, that you will just have complete freedom in our time together. Speak to us where we are with what we're needing. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. There's a verse in Psalm 84, verse 5, says this, "Blessed are those whose strength is in you, who have set their hearts on pilgrimage." I don't know if you're aware of this or not, but there's an entire genre of psalms called pilgrimage songs. These are the songs that people sang on their way to Jerusalem for the annual High Holy Days. Passover, Pentecost, Sukkot were all feast days when all Jewish males above a certain age were required to undertake a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. In fact, if you've ever read the book of Psalms, you'll notice that there's an entire section entitled Psalms of Ascent and Psalms of Descent. The Psalms of Ascent were sung on the way to Jerusalem because Jerusalem is a city on a hill. So you ascend in your journey to the holy city. The Psalms of Descent were the songs you sang on the road back home. So even a portion of Israel's ancient hymn book is dedicated to annual pilgrimages the people of God would make. Today, what I want to do is I want to talk to you about Psalm 84, which is actually entitled A Pilgrimage Song. It's a psalm that was written to remind us that life itself is a pilgrimage. I mean, think about it. Most of the imagery of Scripture treats life like a journey or a pilgrimage. In the Old Testament, God told Abraham to leave his country and go on a pilgrimage to a land he would later show him. Even the Jewish people, before settling in the Promised Land, they were a nomadic people whose sanctuary for their God was a tent that could easily be picked up and moved from place to place. In the book of Exodus, the Jewish people made a pilgrimage from the land of Egypt to the Promised Land. God even gave them a solemn feast to commemorate that event called Passover, where he commanded them to eat this meal in haste with their shoes on and walking sticks in hand to remind them that they were a people on the move. Most times in the Bible, the Christian life is described as a walk. We're told to walk in newness of life, to walk by faith, to walk worthy of our calling, to walk circumspectly, to walk honestly, to walk worthy of the Lord, and to walk in the light, in the truth, in the Spirit, and in love. When it comes down to it, the Christian life really is just one long walk with Jesus. This is why one of my favorite spiritual disciplines is simply to go on a walk with God. It's like one spiritual writer said, to be a Christian is to be a traveler. Or as Robin Davidson put it, we've lost this idea of pilgrimage. We've lost this idea of human beings walking for a very, very long time. It does change you. You know, even the disciples were on a 3.5-year trek with Jesus. Did you know, based on Jesus' recorded travels in the book of Matthew, it's been estimated that he walked 21,525 miles in his lifetime? Try beating that with your Fitbit. So let's take a more intimate look at the journey itself. The pilgrimage we're on is described in terms of three soul movements in Psalm 84. The first one is the soul's aspiration. So let me just say right up front, our aspiration or our ambition is to live in nearness to God. This is how the psalmist said it. He wrote, "My soul yearns, even faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God." Ever since human beings fell and were evicted from paradise, we've been homesick for God. There's an emptiness inside every heart that recognizes there's something missing. So we hunger to be close to God again. Our pilgrimage begins by acknowledging that hunger. I mean, ultimately, that's why we journey. The pilgrim knows that they are not where they belong, that in a sense, we're all dislocated. Our home is not here, and the only place we'll ever feel at home is with God. So one of the vital signs, really one of the surest indicators that we're alive spiritually, is this hunger we have for God. We long to hear him speak, to see him move, to watch him working in our life and the lives of others. We want to be with him. Now, this is so different from what we find in many churches today. Most of what passes for spirituality today has deteriorated into endless narcissism and me-ism. The spiritual life has become all about self-fulfillment. Many think in terms of what's in it for me? How does it make me feel? Does this meet my needs? The psalm radically reorients us by telling us that God is the focus of our spiritual life, not ourselves. Listen again to these words. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. In the Hebrew mind, to be close to the temple meant to be in close proximity to God. Of course, we know that God's presence is not limited to places like temples or church buildings or holy places. The Psalms in another place remind us of this. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Or how about this from Jeremiah? I am a God who is everywhere and not in one place. Do you not know that I am everywhere in heaven and on earth? Let me remind you of a very common mistake I think we make, and that is we easily become fixated on the places where God has been. We want to make shrines in places like that. We want to go to visit them, like the Church of the Nativity in the West Bank, which was built on the site believed to be the birthplace of Christ, or the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, which is the traditional site of the crucifixion and garden tomb, or even places in the U.S. like Loreto Chapel with its miraculous spiral staircase. We want to go to places where we believe God has been. But the genuine follower of Christ cares less about where God has been and cares much more about being where God is right now. You know, Jesus once had a conversation with a Samaritan woman who had her own ideas about sacred places. The Samaritans had built their temple on Mount Gerizim, a place where both Abraham and Jacob had built altars, and a place where Joshua once proclaimed the blessings of God on the people. In other words, it's a place where God had been. That's why she asked Jesus this question. Our fathers worshiped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. In other words, where is the center of worship? Which is the one true holy place, Gerizim or Jerusalem? Listen to Jesus' answer. Jesus replied, "Believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. A time is coming when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth." That's because all true worship is not geographically centered. It's heart-centered. I mean, think about it. If spirituality is about a handful of places around the world where God has visited, then what that means is only a handful of people will ever get to be where God is. Because most people don't have the money or resources to travel great distances to go and see these sacred places. But since God always wants to be accessible to all of his people, he creates a holy place inside every human heart. When you place an emphasis on sacred geographical places, you end up putting God out of reach of the vast majority of people who live on this planet. So it's really not about a handful of special places. Instead, it's about your desire to connect with him. And that's really the point of this psalm. The spiritual journey begins with desire to experience the living God in the depths of your soul. Jesus said something similar in the Beatitudes when he said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be completely satisfied." What Jesus said was, if you hunger and thirst for righteousness, which means to be in right relationship with God, he told us that that hunger would be completely satisfied. In fact, the word that Jesus uses means stuffed. It's the same feeling you have after eating Thanksgiving dinner. It's when you know you simply can't hold any more food. What Jesus is actually saying is, you have as much of God right now as you really want. Now, I've said this before, and I'll say it again. That is the most encouraging and discouraging truth that I know. The implication is if God is filling your life right now, it's because that's what you authentically want. And if God is not deeply involved in your life right now, if you're not experiencing his fullness, it's primarily because you really don't want him all that involved, because you have as much of God as you really want. And that's not dependent on anything else or anybody else. It doesn't matter what kind of church you're in. It doesn't matter whether your small group is meeting your needs. It's not a factor whether your husband or wife is a believer. You have as much of God right now as you really want. And no one, really no one, can get in the way of that but you. Now listen to this. The degree of your connection to God is measured by the intensity of your desire for it. What I'm saying is you don't have to settle for just a taste of God. You can have as much of Him as you really want. A.W. Tozer said it so beautifully when he said, God waits to be wanted. In other words, God really truly does respond to our craving for Him. If you want Him, you'll have Him. It's why St. John of the Cross, one of the great mystics of the Christian church, said that God refuses to be known except by love. When you love Him, when you desire Him, you will have as much of Him as you truly want. So the first thing we learn in Psalm 84 about pilgrimage is that every big thing begins with desire. It's about the pursuit of God, wanting to be where God is. So God has given to each and every one of us an invitation to come away and be with Him. He wants to keep company with you every single day, not just the 20 minutes in the morning during your quiet time, but in the busyness of the workday, in the random conversations throughout the day, and in the frustration of the evening commute. God wants to walk with you, and He wants you to walk with Him. This is why I always love Clement of Alexandria's definition of prayer. He said that prayer is keeping company with God. So that leads us to this next principle we find in the psalm, and that is the soul's approach. The psalmist goes on to tell us this: blessed are those whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. At this point in the psalm, the focus shifts. He moves away from talking about his overwhelming yearning for God to describe this journey that's going to bring him closer to God. He uses a lot of the language of travel. He talks about highways to Zion and passing through the valley and moving from strength to strength. But it's always been this one phrase that stood out to me, and it's this one: they pass through the valley of Baca. I don't know if you're aware of this or not, but modern archaeologists have been unable to locate any valley in Israel ever referred to as Baca. Baca has been translated either as weeping or balsam trees. Balsam trees only grow in really dry places. So this could be a real place, or more likely, it could be a metaphor for the fact that on this journey of life, we're all going to pass through desert experiences. Times of difficulty, times of loss, times when tears are our constant companion. You might even be going through a season like that right now. Really, what the psalmist is saying is, even the most devout saints go through hard times. Here's the deal. God never promised us an easy way. The journey we're on can be hard. It can be very hard. No one gets an exemption from trials or difficulties in life. Acts 14:22 reminds us, we must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. Or this in 1 Peter. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you as though something strange were happening to you. The valley of weeping, the valley of tears, is not optional for the child of God. It's a certainty. In fact, Psalm 84 doesn't say if they pass through the valley of Baca, but as they pass through the valley. You know, just because you have this passion to be with God doesn't mean that everything's going to be going the way you want it to go. The valley can be quite draining. So when you're in the valley, don't camp out, don't quit, don't have a pity party, just keep on moving. I love the way Philina Hewerts said it. She said, we can willfully embark on this journey or not. The choice is ours. Either we decide to journey in hope of growth and change, or we resign to life as it is. You know, when Pharaoh finally let the Israelites go, God didn't take them on the path that was the shortest distance from Egypt to the Promised Land. In fact, you can see on this map, the distance from Egypt to the Promised Land is a relatively short trip. It should have taken less than 2 weeks, but it actually took 40 years. 40 years of desert wandering. I think maybe their map looked a lot more like this one. Now, needless to say, God took them on the roundabout way. The journey took them way longer than any of them ever imagined. One of the things that can be so frustrating to us is this realization that God is not in a hurry. God's primary concern on this journey of life is not our speed. To God, how long it takes to get where we're going is not nearly as important as the kind of people we're becoming along the way. Because that's what the wilderness is all about. It's about soul formation. It's about the people we're becoming in the midst of challenges and difficulties. In the desert, you don't understand why. Why is this happening to me? Why am I not getting what I want? The desert is about trusting that God knows what he's doing, even when you don't. And according to this verse, what the pilgrims do is make it a place of springs. It doesn't say God made it a place of springs. It says pilgrims do that. What he's saying is pilgrims transform the valley. In other words, they leave a path of blessing. They blaze a trail for others who follow. You know, I love hiking. I really do. And if you've ever been hiking, you've probably seen this for yourself. Occasionally, you'll be out in the wilderness and you'll come across a small stack of stones. There's a name for these. They're called cairns. They're there to help you stay on the path, especially when the path ahead is not clearly marked. They're reminders that others have passed this way before you, that you're not alone. This is what you and I do. We're supposed to do, at least in times of suffering. We want to help others who find themselves on that same path. This is why it's often said, God never wastes a hurt. In other words, will your disappointments, your pain, and your confusion serve anyone besides yourself? You know, there's this pastor in South Africa. His name is Trevor Hudson. He says that there are three essential ingredients in pilgrimage. Listen to this. The concept of pilgrimage rests on three essential ingredients: encounter, reflection, and transformation. Now, that's a good word. Stuff happens, to paraphrase a popular saying. You're going to have things happen to you along the way that you don't understand and you can't explain. Now, if pain were the best teacher in life, the whole world would be wise. But in order to be wise, we have to process our pain, and we have to reflect on our pain. And it's only in doing this that we learn about the inadequacies of our view of life and even of God himself. Only when learning takes place are we transformed. So the order is always the same. It's encounter, reflection, and then transformation. Something else fascinating about Pastor Hudson, and this really resonates with me, he discovered that the most Christ-like people he had ever met were all people who lived in close relationship to those who were suffering. What he's saying is there's just something about the Valley of Baca. There's something about going through hardship that either breaks us or causes a depth of spirituality that's absolutely breathtaking to behold. You know, I've had the privilege of traveling overseas and getting up close and personal with some of the world's most vulnerable people. Having had that experience more times than I can remember, I can tell you this. There's always somebody, be it a mother, a father, a child, or a family, who had a walk with God that was unlike anything I'd ever witnessed before. These people with virtually nothing, existing in absolute squalor, possess something so precious either in their outlook or their disposition or in their faith that I envied it and I wished I had it. It's Pastor Hudson's belief, and one that I share, that if you want to stay close to God, you have to stay close to those who are suffering. The truth is we need to be with others who've passed through the Valley of Baca. So this pastor began to wonder, what if I intentionally got my people involved with those who are suffering in our world? What effect might that have? And he discovered that the more his congregation connected to the most vulnerable, the more alive they felt to God. So get this, Pastor Hudson began offering what he called pilgrimages of pain and hope, which is where I got my message title today. These were mission trips that pushed his congregation in close proximity to hurting and vulnerable people. Now, I'll talk more about this as I wrap up, but before I do that, let me talk about this final pilgrim principle, and it's the soul's arrival. The final movement we find in Psalm 84 is about trusting in the goodness of God. Notice what he says next. He says, "For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. Lord Almighty, blessed is the one who trusts in you." What this verse does is affirm that God withholds nothing good from those who walk with him. This is the truth that really lies at the heart of the spiritual journey, learning to trust in the goodness of God. You know, the most important thing about you is what comes to mind when you think of God. In spite of the valley, in spite of the dry times, in spite of the pain, and even the tears, the psalmist says, in the end, the most important truth is this: no good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. The writer is saying, even when I look at my life and I have lots of questions about, you know, why stuff has happened, I still know that you're a good God. It was the author and theologian Richard Niebuhr who once said, most of our problems in life come because we refuse to believe that God is as good as he says he is. This is really where all of our problems start. You see, we have this tendency to look and see what God has not done instead of those good things he has done. Or we get to thinking about all the good that God has done for somebody else that he hasn't done for me. And when we do that, we go down a very different path and we start thinking that maybe God really isn't that good after all. Michelle Van Loon said it so well. She said, a pilgrim is formed by the question, do I trust him? What I believe is this, the goodness of God is a lens, it's a perspective through which we have to view all of life's circumstances. I may not know why this is happening to me right now, but I know God is good. I don't know how to answer this question, but I know God is good. I may be hurting and confused, but I know God is good. Do you trust God? What I know is this, if you don't believe he's good, you will never really or fully trust him. It was Dr. Tony Evans who said, don't lose heart. God has never left your side, and he has a plan to see you through even the most discouraging circumstances. So let me wrap up by telling you about my very first ever pilgrimage. I want to introduce you to a man named Carlos Quinyeros. You'll see his images on the screen. He's the former national director for World Vision Brazil, and he leads a week-long pilgrimage among the poor outside the city of Fortaleza, Brazil, which is the fourth most violent city in the world. Carlos is a man who I think is a walking, breathing Henry Nouwen. He exudes wisdom in everything he says and does. He's a man who truly walks with God. I met Carlos on a prior trip to Brazil and was so impressed by him that I told myself, if I can ever spend more time with this man, I will do everything within my power to do just that. When I learned that he'd be leading a pilgrimage in the summer of 2016, I immediately signed up to go. Now, for those of you who don't know, pilgrimage is actually one of the spiritual disciplines. I love the spiritual disciplines. I love reading my Bible and prayer and meditation and silence and solitude. Those are all powerful and personal disciplines to me. But they're also disciplines that we practice together with other members of the body of Christ, things like fasting and worship and pilgrimage. But regardless of the discipline, every discipline serves the same purpose. You know that, right? Henry Nouwen said it best, in the spiritual life, the word discipline means the effort to create some space in which God can act. So that's what every spiritual discipline does. They create space in my life for God. It's God who does the work of transformation. Your spiritual discipline does not transform you. Your part and my part in spiritual growth is to engage the discipline. We create that space for God rather than allowing the day to be filled with busyness or urgent matters or anything else that clamors for our attention. This is what every spiritual discipline does, and that's especially true of pilgrimage. It carves out time for God to have 100% uninterrupted access to us and for us to have 100% uninterrupted access to him. It's kind of like summer camp for grown-ups, the opportunity to spend extended time with God. Pilgrimage is all about making room for God. Now, one other thing you really need to understand before I can explain to you how pilgrimage works is to hear Matthew 25 in a new way. You know this scripture well. I've quoted it many times. I'm talking about where Jesus says, I was hungry, you fed me. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was naked, you clothed me. I was in prison, you came to visit me. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Now, Matthew 25 means anything at all. At its most fundamental level, it means Christ takes up residence in the desperate, that Christ is literally incarnated in human need. Because he says, I was hungry, you fed me. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. Every one of these conditions that he describes in Matthew 25 represents a state of neediness. So wherever you find great need, that's where you'll find Jesus. Which means if you want to be where Jesus is, you have to go and meet him out in the margins, because you can find him in every hungry belly and in every desperate situation. But many of us don't take what Jesus said in Matthew 25 at face value. Instead, we beg Jesus to come join us where we are. So we gather in our sanitized church environment. We might raise our hands singing and worship and say, God, come be with us. And no doubt he does. The Bible says he inhabits the praise of his people. So God joins us in our time of worship. At other times, we're going through a tough time, experiencing a major setback, struggling with a parental challenge, and we cry out, God be with me. And he joins us there as well. The Bible says God is close to the brokenhearted and near to all who are touched by grief. But like I said, if Matthew 25 means anything at all, it means we never really have to wonder where Jesus is. He's in every orphan child. He's in every desperate single mom. He's in every favela and slum and inner city hellhole. And in all those places and many more, God is crying out to his church, church, come be with me. Bottom line, we will always find God among the poor. So I went on this pilgrimage to meet Jesus where he is. This is an amazing countryside that surrounds Fortaleza, but it's hot. It's arid. It was a week of walking through places as bone dry as West Texas. We passed through the Valley of Baca. In one of these photos, you can see the more human side of the pilgrimage. You'll notice in this photo, that's my head there at the bottom of the photo. But above me is the National Director of Brazil, Joao, who is himself an amazing man of God. And my friend Wellington, who's also World Vision staff in Brazil, and he's above Joao. After a morning of walking through this dry desert heat, we walked about 20 miles a day. We all needed a siesta, and this slab of concrete in the shade was the coolest place that we could find to take a nap. So we walked about 20 miles a day, and every evening, a different family in the community would host us in their homes. We literally stayed in the homes of the poor. Something you should know about Brazilians, they make very efficient use of space. Every room in the house, as well as the porches that surround the house, there are hooks that are embedded into walls so that all living areas and dining rooms and other rooms in the house can easily be converted into sleeping space. The front porches and the trees in the yard also become convenient places to hang your hammock. The Brazilians taught me that Americans don't know how to sleep in hammock because we lay in them lengthwise, which is the most uncomfortable way to sleep in a hammock. Your head is elevated, your feet is elevated. It is totally frustrating to try to sleep that way. They taught me if you lay at a 45 degree angle, so I'm not talking sideways, not 90 degrees, but split the difference, 45 degrees, you will actually lay flat in a hammock. And it's true. And it's a super comfortable way to sleep. So every day on the road, we'd have time to have these long, lingering conversations with our fellow pilgrims, and also plenty of time for quiet personal reflection on what we were seeing and the people we were encountering. Every night, besides staying in the homes of the poor, we would hold a service, either in the street, at a local church, or even from the porch of one of the homes where we were staying, and the community would gather around to listen. On the second night of the pilgrimage, we were staying with a very poor family out in the countryside. In this particular home, there was a mother with two children. I was told the father had died several years prior. Of course, virtually everyone on this pilgrimage spoke Portuguese, as did the people in the homes where we were staying. A few of my fellow pilgrims were bilingual, but most were not. So when we arrived in this rural home, Gabriel, he was the oldest orphan boy. He felt it was his duty to help me, the poor, ignorant American. He knew I couldn't speak his language, so he took it upon himself to figure out how to communicate with me and to help me communicate with others. So he would motion to his mouth to ask me if I was hungry. He would pretend to drink if he thought I was thirsty. Then Gabriel would say the Portuguese word for hunger loudly and slowly. I don't know why it is when you can't speak someone's language, they also assume you're deaf, but they always have to say it loud. If I repeat the word successfully, he would break out in this huge smile from ear to ear and shake his head and say, good. Throughout the night, Gabriel kept pointing to things, identifying them for me. Later that evening, he saw I was laying out in the hammock, out in the yard, beneath a couple of trees, but I was still not asleep. He came out in the yard to check on me. He wanted to make sure I was okay, and through words and gestures, asked if he could help me in any kind of way. Actually, I was just lying there thinking, what if a spider came down from those branches above me and landed on my chest? What would I do? So real spiritual thoughts. Once Gabriel finally scurried off to bed, it dawned on me. Gabriel wanted to alleviate my vulnerability. You see, because he's a child of vulnerability, he could easily identify it in others. He could see it in me. So this child who had every reason to ask something of me, this child who lived in abject poverty, wanted nothing more than to help me because he recognized I was needy. The next morning, when it was time to go, I wanted to tell Gabriel goodbye, but he just disappeared. So I left, not really getting to see him or connect with him one last time. Later, when one of my fellow pilgrims caught up with me, he told me once Gabriel discovered we were leaving, he went to his bedroom to cry. He then told me, "Gabriel wanted you to have this." And he took out a small stone with crystal formations in it. It's beautiful. I'm sure it was one of his priceless treasures. That's when it finally dawned on me. It was Gabriel that God wanted me to spend time with, not Carlos. It was Gabriel who had something to teach me about generosity and compassion. It was Gabriel who was there to minister to me in my neediness. It was Gabriel who appeared to me in my isolation to draw me into the circle of caring and love. Gabriel had a gift for me, and it wasn't that stone. It was what the stone represented, his love. You see, that's really the purpose of pilgrimage, really the purpose behind every spiritual discipline. It's the Christ encounter. Jesus met me and a boy named Gabriel. I'll never forget him for as long as I live. I keep his gift in a small box on my nightstand. His life impacted mine, and I'm changed as a result. What I'm telling you is God is present all around the world in the Gabriels and Olivers and Marias. He's in your sponsored child and mine. You can always find Jesus where he's always been, in the margins, in the shanty towns, in the favelas, in the places of desperate need. Jesus is in them, and he's calling out to his church, "Church, come be with me." You and I were on a journey into the very heart of God. And on this journey of life, God is working all the time in our life to redeem our life, to make sure that we know that we are loved, that we are cherished, that come what may, no matter what we're going through, that he is with us. Some of you today, you're going through the valley of Baca. You're going through a time of real spiritual dryness, a time that you just feel desolate. Maybe even you feel kind of dead inside. I get that. But please don't doubt in the dark what God has shown you in the light, that he loves you, that he's with you. Again and again, remind yourself and look for the evidence of the goodness of God in your life right now, because it's there. You just stop looking for it. You became so fixated on this pain, on this hurt, on this question, on this problem, that your eyesight has narrowed down to this small tunnel, and you've got to lift your eyes up. You've got to see the people that are surrounding you right now, the people who are loving you, these happy coincidences that just seem to work out in just the right way for you and your circumstance. We got to remember that God is always with us. And more than anything, because our desire on this journey of life, on this pilgrimage, is to experience more and more of God, then let's go and find him where he actually is. Let's go out in our neighborhoods. Let's find the elderly people whose families have moved far away, who just need some help, who just need someone to care, who just need a listening ear. Let's find those children who are vulnerable in our community and make sure that they know that they're loved by God. Let's step into situations that maybe make us feel uncomfortable, because we know that when we step into those situations, especially situations of deep need, that Jesus is already present in that situation. We just need to become conscious of it. We need to become aware of it. God met me in a young boy named Gabriel, and there's plenty of Gabriels in this world, and Jesus is just waiting for you to come and be with him where he is. Let's pray. Father, I just want to thank you for Psalm 84, for this example of what life is really like, that our journey in life begins with this hunger for you because we know we're out of place. We're not where we belong. And that unsettledness causes us to search, to go on this journey in hopes of finding you. And Lord, you can be found, and you are found in those desires. You're found in that longing to know you, to love you, to be with you. God, you respond to that desire, and I'm thankful for those promises. God, I pray for those who are walking through a very difficult time right now, who are passing through their own valley of Baca. I pray, God, that you would lift their eyes above their circumstance to see evidence of your presence. I pray, God, that even as they pass through the valley, that they would leave reminders, they would leave messages of hope for others, because they are not the only person who will ever pass that way. Help them to construct their cairns, to leave the markers, to say, if you feel like you're losing your way, this is the way. Go down this path, because this is the path that leads you deeper into the heart of God. And God, may you always, in our life, remind us of your goodness. Remind us, God, through the people that surround us and the circumstances you're bringing into our life, that God, though we may feel abandoned, we are never truly so. That God, you are always with us. You're always aware of what you're going through, we're going through, and you're always at work, God, redeeming what is to work it to our good and to our growth. So we thank you, God, that we've had this time together. We ask, God, that you would just meet us where we are with what we're needing. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. We are so incredibly grateful that you would join us today. Please take this message, share it on social media, like it, tell your friends about it. We'd love to impact even more people for the cause of Christ. God bless you. Can't wait to see you again next week.